Hi there, guys. Alec Pierce, scuba, vintage scuba specifically today. And when I started diving in 1958, we had pressure gauges. They weren't submersible. In fact, if they got wet, they were destroyed. And what we would do on our good old steel 72s is we would check the pressure before we went in on our dive to make sure we had a full tank. And then we would make the dive. We invariably, means always, we always had a J-valve. It was mandatory equipment, just as SPGs and BCDs and computers and safe seconds are mandatory today. We had mandatory equipment in those days too. J-valve, reserve, and a 12-inch knife. You didn't have to have the 12-inch knife, but you weren't really a diver if you didn't. I mean, let me tell you. So anyway, off we went. How did we know how much air we had? We didn't. We had no idea. Through experience over many, many dives, we learned approximately how long the air would last at a certain depth, certain activity, currents, and all those other factors. We would learn just by experience. Yes, we ran out of air very often. It's like when I was racing motorcycles in the mid-60s. As the fellow I was racing with used to say, you'll never know how quickly you can go around that corner until you fall down. When you fall down, you know that's as fast as you can go. And there was some truth to that. It's a little bit that way in the early days of scuba. We went and tried things. If they didn't work, we didn't do them again. We ran out of air very often, but we had a reserve. And we were careful as experienced old school divers, S-K-O-O-L, as my friends at Simply Scuba say. We learned, you know, old school divers. We watched ourselves, we were a little bit careful, and we learned from it. I think it was about 61 or 62 or 63 that the first submersible pressure gauge came along. And wow, what a change that was for the sport of scuba diving. It made scuba diving safe, easy, and fun. It's about the same as dive computers today. Dive computers started a long time ago, actually. I have a prototype of the first mechanical dive computer from the 50s. I'll show it to you sometime. I think we did it, didn't we? But anyway, but real dive computers. Reliable dive computers and affordable dive computers appeared, well, maybe in the 80s and became popular in the 90s, and now in the early 2000s, they are becoming mandatory. Many dive centers, resorts require them. You can't dive without them. And computers have done for scuba diving today what SPGs did back in the 60s. Kevin's going to find out the exact year that that first pressure gauge called the Seaview gauge, Seaview, V-U-E. It must be a British spelling. Anyway, here it is here. That's it, right there. Early 60s, do I have that right way up? Early 60s, you see the light on there? Can you see Seaview, the very first submersible pressure gauge? This was invented, developed, and marketed by Sportsways by a very good friend of mine, Sam LeCocq. Excellent diver, early diver, worked with all the big companies, and he founded and ran Sportsways, invented many, many innovative ideas. But this was probably the best one, the biggest impact on scuba diving they ever made. And this is what it looked like, just like this. This is an original, black, high-pressure hose, big hole in the end. That's changed now, they're not like that. No swivel, it doesn't swivel, all brass. You can actually take this head off and take it off and replace the glass and clean it up a little bit and put it back together. They all had a band on them to attach to your weight belt. Didn't have BCs. So attached to your weight belt so you wouldn't lose it. And that's the way it was. All Sportsways products had this little metal band. It identifies this as an original Sportsways. A little metal band clamped around the hose. It says Sportsways, really good gear, or whatever it says on there. And that's how you could identify a genuine Sportsways product. That's it. That's the first submersible pressure gauge, the first practical one anyway, that was sold to the public. There was one problem with this gauge. It was too expensive. So, I mean, these cost about $40 or more. I'm not exactly sure. You could buy a regulator for that kind of money. But anyway, they were relatively expensive as a new product. So a lot of divers didn't use them. They relied on their good old J-valve. And I hear today, here we go again, I hear today divers saying, well, I like those SPGs, but I ain't giving up my J-valve. Okay, I got no problem with that. If you want to stick with your J-valve, that's just fine. Most cars have disc brakes. If you want to go out with cable-operated drum brakes, go for it. Not a good analogy, but anyway, you do what you want. But anyway, these pretty soon, these became much better. Why were these so much better? Well, simply, Now, we put our regulator on the tank and we get checked. Yep, tank's full. And then at any point through the dive, we get, yep, tank's half empty. Whoops, tank's empty. You see? So we knew how much air we had left through the dive. And we could plan the dive. We'll go to 60 feet, then we'll come up to 40, and then we'll do 30. We'll check our pressure if we have enough air. And all that kind of, you've all done this. You've been on dive charters, and the captain says, now make sure you come back with 500 PSI, or we can't let you dive in the afternoon. Well, how are you going to do that without a pressure? You're exactly right. So these really made scuba diving safe and a lot more fun, too, because you'd relax a little bit. You weren't always scratching your head underwater, which is hard through a wetsuit hood, and wondering how much longer your air was going to last. So that was the very first gauge. Other companies came up with it. Here's the same gauge from Decor. Same gauge, high pressure hose, big hole in the end, doesn't swivel, same gauge, but from Decor. So soon after Sam LeCocq from Sportsways, my buddy down there, invented the SeaView gauge, it wasn't long after that that other companies came up with their own version. So it became popular pretty quickly. The price went down, and pretty soon almost all divers were using them. They made some improvements over the ages. One of the first things they did was put a swivel on it, because the problem with the original one was that when it fastened into your regulator, screwed into the regulator, when you brought it around in front of you, it could be upside down, and you couldn't twist that high-pressure hose very easily to get it straight. So that was a bit of a nuisance. So it wasn't very long before they put a swivel on it. So this one, you see, has a swivel on it. Oh, not that one. This one here has a swivel on it. Same strap, same hose, everything else. And this is, what is this? This is the same gauge, a swivel on it. But, okay, this also happens to have a capillary depth gauge around the outside. Yeah, that's a good idea. Capillary depth gauges were quite common. If you don't know what a capillary depth gauge is, again, go back in my playlist here, you'll find a capillary depth gauge. And it has a little capillary depth gauge around the outside. So the swivel was good. It was still on the end of the hose, though, and that was a bit of a nuisance. So it wasn't long before they figured out that this is better. So now your hose goes in the rig, and there it is. It's on the end of the hose like this. And this is what you get today. When you buy an SPG today, this is what you get, just like this. Now, it's not exactly the same. First of all, the hose doesn't have a big hole in it. If you've watched any of my tech tips, I think it's in Tech Tips, Kevin, it has the tiny, tiny holes, so if the hose breaks, it doesn't fly around. You can still get brass gauges, you can if you look for them, but generally speaking, SPGs today are relatively inexpensive, and all you can get a good one for $40, not really, $100 maybe, which is pretty cheap. And they swivel, and they're lightweight, and they're plastic, and they're easy to read, and they're accurate, and they work really, really well. There's another one just to show you how they develop. So there's another one now, you see? Still old. I know by the hose end on it, right? And it's a swivel on the end there. It's brass. It's really, really good. And this one has the capillary depth gauge and swivel. So you see how it's developing? It's slowly becoming more and more useful for the divers. And that's how it started. There weren't any. And then the first one came out, Sam LeCocq, commercially available, Sam LeCocq from Sportsways, and with no swivel at the end and on it wet. And then there were more and more improvements. So here's one here from a company called Farallon. Now, Farallon was a great company, no longer around, but Farallon had a swivel pressure gauge, right? And same as all these other ones, same type. But what they did, you're watching? Depth gauge on the back. It's kind of neat, you see? So you had your pressure gauge on one side, and then you swing it around, and there's your depth gauge. And that's pretty good. That's a good idea. Now, today, we don't think that's such a big idea. But back then, wow, they marketed this, and our SPG has a depth gauge. They didn't call them SPGs back then. Our pressure gauge has a depth gauge, so you can check your pressure and your depth at the same time with a nice swivel on there. Big, easy to read, very luminescent at night. I remember these gauges really well, and so that was excellent. And then here's another example, a little bit different. This is from Healthways, big company as well. Now, this particular gauge is excellent. There were some problems with the early gauges with the high pressure and the high pressure hose bursting. That still happens today. Now, there are other provisions. Again, if you go to my tech tips, you'll learn what they do today to ensure that a high pressure hose doesn't cause a problem. And the high pressure hoses, they actually have a row of holes, little holes right down the rubber covering. Now, we talk about that in tech tips, I'm pretty sure, right, Kev? Yeah, but this one, what they did for Healthways, they simply made an extra strong one. This is made of braided steel, stainless braided steel. No rubber covering on it. Seems like a good idea, right? Not very popular, because it didn't look very good. Yeah, the reason they decided after 2 years to drop it, nobody bought them. They didn't like the look of them. But that's just another step in development. So then, what happened next? How did pressure gauges, SPGs, become what we have today, what we call consoles? Well, I'm going to make up a little story here. I have no idea what the guy's name is. Let's call him Bill. very active diver, and he had a compass on his arm, and he had a depth gauge on his arm, and he had a watch over here, and he had a submersible pressure gauge, and quite frankly, it was getting to be a nuisance to put all those gauges on over top of his way. He lived in, I don't know, Minnesota. So Bill in Minnesota, this is a pain in the butt. What am I going to do? He happened to be a very handy woodworker. So he took a really nice piece of maple, and he cut a triangular piece of maple, about this size, like that. And he took his favorite pressure gauge, SPG, and he mounted the pressure gauge in the bottom corner of that triangular piece of maple wood. And then in the next corner, he mounted his depth gauge. And then the other corner, he mounted this compass. And so he had this nice piece of wood. He finished it really, really well with some marine spar varnish. It looked great. Mounted the three gauges. Off he went on his first dive. And his buddies looked at him. What is that? That's my dashboard. That's where all my gauges are now. I don't have to strap them onto my wrist. It's not a problem getting my gloves or anything on. I just put it on my regulator and I pick it up. And there's my dashboard. It looked a little bit like this. But this is not Bill's. This is not a nice piece of maple with marine varnish on it. No. This is from a company called Penform. Penform. Not around anymore, unfortunately, but they had this, they saw Bill's. Again, I'm making up the story, but that is approximately how it happened, folks. It's really how it happened. They saw that, and as often as the case, a company said, that's a great idea. Divers will love it. We can do it better. I don't know if it's better or not, but what they did was they were into plastics. This is early plastics, a forming of plastics, and so they had a clamshell. And 90% of the gauges were the same shape and size. So they could sell these plastic shells with three screws to any diver. And the diver would just simply put his pressure gauge in there, his depth gauge up there, and there's couples in there, three screws in the back, and off you went. Just screws right to your regulator, and there you go. There's your dashboard. There you go. Thanks to Bill. Thank you, Bill. That's what happened. Now, this particular shape, after a while, they decided this particular shape wasn't the most convenient, so they changed Penform, changed the shape, and they came up with this one, which not only is a more familiar shape to what you all have seen, but it also is bright yellow. It can be different colors. You can get blue and black and yellow. This is a modern console, just like a modern console. And Penform did really, really well. They had other plastic products too, but they did really well with these until eventually the major scuba manufacturers, that is U.S. Divers and Decor, and Healthways was gone by then, Oceanic, other companies, they started to come out with their own console, rubber molded rubber consoles, so that the depth gauge, the pressure gauge, the depth gauge, and the compass were all mounted in a very small, very compact, hard black rubber. It looked good and it worked really well. And we now have our modern console that we know from today. There you go. That's what happened to SPGs. Now, why am I sharing this with you? I'm sharing this with you because it's kind of interesting. A little bit of history in there, how it came out, what they used to look like. So now you're smarter than the average diver. When you go to your next club meeting and you're sitting around having a beer afterwards, you can brag a little bit and say, you got it. And I don't know, maybe you can win a bet. I'm also sharing this with you because this is a piece of history. In fact, in my personal opinion, SPGs are a piece of scuba history. That's right. Now, there's lots of them around, don't get me wrong. You can still buy them. Every dive store has them. But fewer and fewer dive stores are selling SPGs. I know some of you guys out there, you've got a nice new computer and you're insisting that you should still have an SPG. Hey, go for it. Carry that SPG around. If it makes you feel better, go for it. But if you have a good computer, meaning a late model computer, not one more than 10 years old, made in the last 5 to 6 years, because they're much more reliable, flood-free, the battery compartment is sealed, and a lot less expensive too. What used to cost $1,000 years ago now costs $300, and they do all of your air consumption, not just your air pressure. An SPG shows the air pressure, but it doesn't show you how long that air will last, does it? No. If you have an SPG and it shows you have 1,500 PSI left, it tells you you have 1,500 PSI of air left. What does that mean? Well, if you're at 100 feet, you better start for the surface. If you're at 30 feet, you can go deeper or relax for a while. See, it makes a difference. It doesn't tell you that information. You still have to use your brain. And we're down there to scuba dive, not to think. This is not a math class. And you may not have a dive watch, you know. So the computer is fantastic because it not only tells you how much air you have, if you need that information, it tells you how much longer it's going to last at your current under the current dive situation, depth, temperature, and so on. So you can adjust your diving to suit your remaining air. You can't do that with an SPG. A dive computer does so much more than an SPG. As I say, I'm quite sure, maybe not in my lifetime, but I'll bet you in the next 10 years, SPGs would become a piece of history. And maybe you should get one of these, huh? So you have a piece of diving history. Now, I'm not trying to irritate people that think SPGs are the greatest thing since sliced bread, because they're right. It was the greatest thing since sliced bread. Not anymore. When you do it, makes you feel good. There you go. A little bit about SPGs from Alec Pierce. I knew a fellow by the name of Keith, and he was an expert on handguns. And he wrote a book. And the title of the book was Hell, I Was There. And kind of, I don't know everything, that's for sure. The older I get, the less I know. But SPGs, I was there. I know about them. Okay, have fun. See you simply scuba. Thanks again. Bye-bye.